Bulinda Audio and the O'Brien Press present this unabridged recording of Sally in the City of Dreams, written by Judi Curtin and read by Caroline Lennon. Dedication. For little Sally, whose great-great-grandmother inspired this story. Ireland, early 1900s. Chapter 1. Am I too late for the wake? Our neighbour, Abina, pulled her shawl tighter on her skinny shoulders and peered greedily around our little house, eyeing the food set out on the table in the corner. You know well you're the first here, said Bridget. Aren't you always? Mammy glared at her, and Bridget looked ashamed. Should I try a little at that bacon to see if it's fresh? Said Abina. Wouldn't it be terrible altogether if the whole village were to die of poisoning? Without waiting for an answer, she went to the table and helped herself to a huge chunk of bacon and two thick slices of bread. I was tempted to get food for myself, but Mammy had warned us that family should eat last, in case there wasn't enough. This seemed unlikely, though, as I'd never before seen such a big and fine spread, not even on Christmas Day. My brother Tom slipped his hand into mine. Sally, I thought this party was for you and Bridget, he whispered. But now Abina says it's a wake, and I know wakes are only for dead people. So does that mean you two are going to die like Grandad did? I don't want you to die. Oh, Bridget and I are hardy out, I said, squeezing his warm little hand. We won't die for years and years. So why did Abina say it's a wake? This isn't like the wake we had for Grandad, I said. This is different. This is an American wake. What does that mean? He crumpled up his little face as he tried to work it out. Well, Bridget and I aren't going to die, I said. But tomorrow we are going very far away. We're having this wake so people can say goodbye to us, that's all. Why do you have to go so far away? I like playing with you. You'll still have Aggie and Joe. They won't play with me. They say I'm only a baby. I knew he was right. Aggie and Joe lived in their own little world, with no room for Tom or anyone else. So, instead of answering, I gave Tom a big hug. When he was born, Aggie and Joe were two wild young things. And while Mammy ran around after them, I spent many hours rocking my newest brother and singing to him. I loved all my siblings, but Tom was the baby and my special pet. I like when you read me the book about beautiful Princess Tiana, he said. I like it when you cuddle me at night and tell me I'm your best boy. Why can't you and Bridget stay here with me and Mammy and Daddy and Aggie and Joe and Granny? Oh, Tom, Bridget and I have to go. There's no jobs here. And Daddy's little farm doesn't make enough money to pay the rent and feed us all. There's plenty of work in America. There's all kinds of opportunities for girls like us. Are you sad? He asked. I didn't know how to answer. I was sad about leaving the people I loved. And I was scared, but also very, very excited for our big adventure. Will you ever come back? There was a shake in his voice. Most people who went to America never returned. The few who did waited years and years and seemed so changed, no one even knew them anymore. But how could I break my brother's heart by telling him this sad truth? Of course we'll come back, I said, smiling at him. And we'll bring you a big trunk full of toys and sweet cakes and velvet breeches. Ooh, I won't wear velvet breeches. They'll all laugh at me. No velvet breeches then. Just toys and books and cakes and so many sweets, it'll take you 100 years to eat them all. Now Abina came over. wiping her mouth with the back of her hand. I had a man courting me once long ago. Oh, he was a handsome one, he was. He went to America and said he'd get a fine place for us to live, but he never did send for me. I wouldn't blame him, muttered Bridget. And I tried not to laugh as I looked at Abina's tangled grey hair and filthy clothes. Bridget Bernadette, said Mammy, who always used her full name when she was cross. If you can't say something kind, then don't say anything at all. Yes, Mammy, said Bridget, and I could see she really was sorry. She took Abina's skinny arm and brought her to a stool by the fire and spent half an hour bringing her plate after plate of food and listening to boring stories about long ago. Bridget is nearly a year older than me. But Daddy says she hasn't the sense she was born with. She's got the kindest heart in the world, but you wouldn't always see that at first. I hoped her big mouth wasn't going to get us into trouble in New York. Soon our little house was full of people. Some brought food, and some brought cans of milk, and some pressed coins into my hand or Bridget's. Money to help us get settled in our new lives. A few, like Abina, brought nothing, but ate as if they hadn't seen food for months. And Mammy welcomed them all, never judging and trying to give everyone a chance. I hoped Bridget and I would meet people like Mammy in New York. Granny, who couldn't walk anymore, sat up in her bed in the corner of the room. She loved company and chatted with anyone who came near. I sat with her for a little while, and she held my hand in her warm, bony one. Granny always petted us children and never got cross with us, the way Mammy and Daddy sometimes did. I tried not to think about how very old she was and how I might not see her again after tomorrow. Some of the neighbours brought fiddles and whistles, and a man from the other side of the village stood up and sang. Granny clapped her hands in time to the music. Daddy and Bridget somehow found a space to dance their favourite jig, while everyone around them clapped and stamped their feet and laughed and sang, and for a while the house was full of joy. Then Bridget tried to do a high kick, and when she came down, her foot went from under her, and she fell to the ground with her skirts up around her knees. The music stopped, and everyone roared with laughter, but I knew trouble wasn't far away. Bridget hates when people laugh at her. She scrambled to her feet with wild hair and a cross red face. What are ye laughing at? She cried. Step forward, anyone who'd like to tell me what you're laughing at. Her eyes were flashing, and even the big grown-up men put their heads down and looked at their feet. A few brave children giggled, but their mothers made them stop. Well, said Bridget, I could have broken me neck, and all ye can do is laugh like jackasses. Daddy put his arm around her shoulder. Come, Bridget, he said. Granny wants to talk to you. And because Bridget loves Granny so much, she calmed down and let herself be moved away from the centre of the floor. Play some more, said Mammy to the musicians. So they played another merry tune, and the party was saved. A little later, a man sang a sad song about families being parted, and people told him to hush. And I saw Mammy go pale and slip out the door. By the time I found her, she was a little way up the road, sitting on a wall and crying quietly. I sat up beside her and put my arm around her, rubbing circles on her back, the way she'd done to me 100 times. Oh, Sally, she cried, I'm glad you girls will have a great new life in America, but what will I do without you at all? You'll have Daddy and Aggie and Joe and Tom and Granny and Auntie Sarah and all your friends. And maybe one day Bridget and I will... Hush now, Sal, she said, putting one finger over my lips. Don't make promises you can't keep. Just sit here a while and keep me company, and in a minute we'll go back inside and join the party. I'll write to you, Mammy, I said. You know Bridget. She'll have great intentions of writing, but she will probably never get around to it. I won't be like that, though. I promise. I'll write enough for both of us. Truly? I'll write so often, you'll be fed up of reading my letters and be wishing for a break. Well, that will never happen, and that's for sure. I'll treasure every word you write about your new life. And I'll write back and tell you how things are going on here. And it won't feel as if we're apart at all. Now, tears came to my eyes as I tried to picture a world where I wouldn't see my dear ones every single day. I wiped the tears away, though. This was a time for being brave and bold. This was the start of my new life. Chapter 2. Wake up, girls. It's time to go. It was still dark outside, but Mammy's candle gave enough light for Bridget and me to get up and wash our faces and put on our best dresses, which we'd laid out on the chair the night before. Aggie and Joe half woke, stretching up sleepy arms for hugs, before settling back to their dreams. I pulled the blankets over their shoulders so they wouldn't get cold. I knew that sometimes Miss Bridget and me, but in their own little world of two, things wouldn't change too much. Tom was curled in a corner of the bed, with a little smile on his face, as if he were dreaming of something nice. I picked his book up from the floor and turned to the page with the picture of beautiful Princess Tiana, so he'd have something pretty to look at when he woke. Bridget and I kissed his soft, warm cheek. Goodbye, my sweet boy, I whispered. Be good and safe until... I choked on the last words as Bridget pulled me away. No tears, she whispered. We promised each other, remember? If we cry, we'll only make it harder for Mammy and Daddy. She was right, but I wasn't sure I could keep my promise. I patted Tom's curls, which were damp from sleep, and followed Bridget out to the kitchen. Come here, Sal, said Mammy, taking the brush from the shelf. Let me plait your hair for you one last. She didn't finish, and I pinched my arm to stop myself from crying. Of course I could plait my own hair in America. I'd been doing it for years. But I still loved Mammy's gentle but firm touch and how she hummed to herself as she combed and braided. So I sat quietly and tried to store up the moment, like a treasure, so I could take it out in the future and remember it. I've heated some milk for you, said Daddy, handing Bridget and me a cup. And here's some bread for the journey to Queenstown, said Mammy, jumping up and wrapping a few slices in a cloth. They say you'll get nice food on the boat, and you won't go hungry at all. Neither Mammy nor Daddy looked at us, and their voices were funny, as if they'd both caught colds overnight. I drank my milk and looked at the trunk that was next to the door. Inside were our few bits of clothes and the presents of stockings and scarves some of the neighbour women had made for Bridget and me. Also in the trunk was the seed cake Mammy had made as a present for her second cousin, Catherine, who was letting us stay with her in New York and had found jobs for Bridget and me. What's cousin Catherine like? I asked, suddenly afraid. Catherine left Ireland before Bridget and I were born, so we'd never met her. I can barely remember her, said Mammy. She grew up a few miles away from here, and we were both only young ones when she left. Is she kind? Will she be good to us? Didn't she send the money for your fare? Said Mammy. And I heard a few years ago, she sent money for another two girls from the other side of her family. Wasn't that a very kind thing to do? Are those girls still with her? I had no idea what New York was like, but I suddenly had a lovely picture in my mind. Cousin Catherine would have a big house, maybe near a stream or waterfall. There would be lots of bedrooms, and all the girls she brought to America would live there and be best friends. I think there was a letter saying those two girls moved on to California a few months ago, said Mammy. California, I sighed. That sounded even more exotic than New York. Maybe one day I'd actually see it for myself. There was a sharp knock on the door. That'll be Connie, said Daddy. Aren't you lucky girls altogether that he has business in town today and has room for you on the cart?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.